This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad. We are glad that you are joining us in this virtual space to worship our risen Lord on this beautiful Sunday morning.
Amen. To God be the glory, great things God has done in this space. On this Sabbath morning, on this Sabbath day, we're so glad that as we've been ministered to in song and in prayer, that we now will go to God's word. Please pray with me. Eternal God, giving you thanks for this day and this opportunity to preach and teach. God, we know that we didn't come this far by ourselves. And so we pray to that same spirit that brought us through many danger, toils, and tears, God would be with us now. Thank you, God, for what our eyes have already seen, our ears have already heard, for what our spirits have already felt. God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts continue to be pleasing and acceptable in your sight. O Lord, our strength and our most blessed Redeemer. We ask this prayer in the precious name of Jesus, our Savior. Amen. Amen, amen. Good morning, friends. We're so glad again that you have joined us for worship today. We're thankful for the spirit that has touched your heart right where you are as you are viewing this service to Pastor Lansden and to all of the staff of the church, our minister of music, Dr. Monroe, and the great musicians we have here, our AV staff, to our floor minister, Minister Donna, thank you again for your presence. And for our centurions and others that make this a safe space for us to share God's word each and every week. Today, as we start a new series of sermons around the power and the effectiveness of God and the touch of Jesus Christ in your life, I invite you, if you have your word, to please turn with me to the Gospel of Matthew, Matthew chapter 8. We'll be reading to you those three verses, 14 through 17, from a New Living Translation of God's Holy Word. For the Bible says, "And when Jesus arrived at Peter's house, Peter's mother-in-law was sick in bed with a high fever. But when Jesus touched her hand, the fever left her. Then she got up and prepared a meal for him. And that evening, many demon-possessed people were brought to Jesus. He cast out the evil spirits with a simple command, and he healed all the sick. This fulfilled the word of the Lord through the prophet Isaiah, who said, 'He took our sickness and removed our disease.'" Friends, this is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. And today, with the aid of the Holy Spirit, we want to look at verse 14 of this pericope, for it says, "When Jesus arrived at Peter's house." And with your encouragement, I want to preach and teach on a subject today, house calls. House calls. My friends, long before the days of Home Chef, Green Chef, Purple Carrot, and Blue Apron, before the days, y'all, of Nutrisystem and DoorDash, Uber Eats, and Grubhub, some of us knew something about home delivery and house calls. If you can say amen right where you are. Amen. Y'all, before the days of Amazon and FedEx, UPS and Walmart delivery, before the days of Domino Pizza, Pizza Hut, Jimmy John's and PF Chains, some of us, if not many of us, knew a thing or two about a noisy truck outside, a horn blowing in a car, a ring at the doorbell, or a knock on the screen door indicating that you had a home delivery or a house call. But come on with me and remember that before all of these new things, there was the milkman, the egg man, the ice cream man, and the Charlie Chips man. There was the independent life man, the North Carolina mutual man, the derm life man, and the burial or funeral insurance man. And to be inclusive, y'all, there was also the Stanley Products lady, the Tupperware lady, the Flavor and Pepper lady, and of course, the Avon lady. Home deliveries, y'all, was a way of life. Home delivery, y'all, was not a convenience, not from a VIP status, not because you got bonus points, or it was not because of a health pandemic, but it was just a way of life. Home delivery and house calls, y'all, they cross all areas of economics. They cross all cultural norms. They intersected all of the basic needs, and it was life given to all the consumers, home deliveries and house calls. And my friends, if you are following along with me right now, I hope you can get my train and understand that I'm talking ultimately, y'all, about a home delivery or a house call from our Lord Jesus Christ. I want to introduce to you, y'all, an idea and a concept of Jesus coming into your house, into your space, into your place, meeting you face to face to address your spiritual needs. Let's go to the Word, because I think you can learn something today about a house call. Go ahead and type in the chat box right there, house call. Because you see, as amazing as it sounds, we serve a God, y'all, who sits high and looks low, but is never too busy and never too important to make a house call. Jesus did this routinely, for we see it in the New Testament, for in the Gospel of Matthew in chapter 9, he had dinner at Levi's house, a house call. In Luke chapter 7, Jesus agreed to go to the centurion's house to heal the servant, again, making a house call. In Luke chapter 7, verse 36, he is at Simon the Pharisee's house, having dinner with tax collectors, again, at a house call. He is in Luke chapter 14, verse 1, at the home of the man with the dropsy, another Pharisee making a house call. He went to Zacchaeus' house. You remember he talked to him, told him to come down out of the tree. Zacchaeus, I'm going to your house to have dinner to sup with you, and we're going to have a house call. We find him going to see Mary and Martha, then leaving their house, going to the cemetery, getting Lazarus up out of the grave, going back to the house again for a house call. We find him going, y'all, over and over again, now coming to us at Peter's mother-in-law's house for what else than a house call. And y'all, I'm glad to say on this Sunday morning that I serve a God and you serve a God that ain't ashamed to make a house call. I am so happy right now to give God praise to the one who sits high and looks low, still does not get beyond my knees to make a house call. House call, house call, house call. And before I go deeper into the text, I just want to raise a question to you this morning. What would you do if Jesus showed up at your house? How would you react if your ADT or your CPI doorbell show a picture of Jesus on your phone or your smart device, him ringing the bell and making a house call? Would you start picking up stuff and cleaning up stuff and throwing stuff out and putting stuff away? Would you have to change the TV channels or change the radio station? Or would you have to put on some different music? Would you have to open up the windows and start spraying some Febreze in your house? What would you have to do if Jesus showed up for a house call? Well, now, before you contemplate over all of that, let me just stay in my lane and stay with the text, because I think there are some powerful truths to be told here and some exciting lessons we can learn as we explore our subject this morning called house calls. But now, I don't want to move too quickly, because I just want to go ahead and be honest and have some fun. What would it be before you met Jesus if he showed up surprisingly that you would just go ahead and type in the chat box that you would have to hide from the Lord? You see, what I want to talk to you about this morning is these miracles, these encounters that Jesus make in the houses, in the homes of folk in the Bible, but also how Jesus can make those same encounters in our lives today. For the first miracle that's recorded in Matthew chapter 8 is the miracle of Jesus healing the man with leprosy, a house call. The second miracle recorded was when Jesus went to the centurion's house to heal the servant who was sick and paralyzed, again making a house call. And what we read about today, this third miracle in the Gospel of Matthew chapter 8, is when Jesus comes to Peter's mother-in-law's house for a house call. And the first point I want to make, y'all, is when God makes a house call to you, the presence changes, the atmosphere changes, and the presence of Christ makes a difference. The thing I want you to gather first of all from this text, y'all, is that when God makes a house call to you, God wants to change your atmosphere and your presence. Look what the text says. It says when Jesus arrived at Peter's house, Peter's mother-in-law was sick in bed with a high fever. Now recognize that Luke says it was an excruciating fever. Luke, being the doctor, physician, he's talking about this is not just a low-grade fever. This is a high fever. And as soon as Jesus entered the house, y'all, in the home of Peter and his mother-in-law, he saw the mother-in-law that was in the bed. Now recognize, not only does Peter live in this house, his wife live in this house, his brother Andrew lives in this house, and the mother-in-law lives in the house. Okay, you're not feeling it. You've got two grown men and at least two grown women living together in the same house. Now, somebody looking at me right now said, Lord, have mercy. I thought my living situation was tough. But when you see what's in the Bible, aren't you glad that Jesus does not count it robbery to go see Peter and his mother-in-law and his brother and his wife all in the same house? And the Bible says that when he saw Peter's mother-in-law, immediately he recognized something was wrong, something was ill, something was happening. The Bible says she was with a fever. Now, understand, y'all, people may not have thought the seriousness of having a fever, but in Palestine, in Northeast Africa, a fever oftentimes was connected to malaria. And the fever, y'all, it could last a day and you're over with, or it could last an hour and you're dead. All kinds of infections, y'all, can run and make the body temperature go up. A fever, understand this, is a symptom of the problem. Okay, a fever is a symptom of the problem. It is not the problem. It is a symptom thereof. The fever may go down, but the infection may begin to still be in the body. And what you must understand that Jesus is recognizing in a real sense, Pastor Lansden, that many of us suffer sinful fevers. We suffer a temperature that sin gets into our lives. And the problem that we have to deal with, y'all, is not taking an aspirin, that is reading one scripture, not singing a gospel song, that is thinking we can sing it away, but we've got to go to the real problem, the source of the sin in our lives. You see, when a person catches a fever, y'all, there sometimes are chills for one minute, and the person could be hot one minute and cold the next. Somebody knows what I'm talking about. When you catch a fever, it can take your strength out of you. It can make you not want to eat. It can make you not want to sleep. It can make you not want to get up and go to work. I ain't talking fever now. I'm talking sin. I'm talking your broken relationship from Almighty God. When you catch that fever, that sinful fever, you need the Lord to come in and redeem and release you of that illness. You see, the Bible helps us understand as that Jesus recognized that Peter's mother-in-law had a fever, he also recognizes in our lives that we too are boiling over sometimes with some bad attitudes, some bad thoughts, some bad spirits. Okay, all right. You all holy on this first Sunday in March, but now you do know that you ain't always been what you are right now. Praise the Lord. And thanks be to God, you ain't what you used to be in the past. But you see, when you accept the presence of God in your life, the presence makes a let me say it like this. As a believer in Almighty God and a follower of Jesus Christ, your presence ought to make a difference wherever you go. As one who is fire baptized, filled with the Holy Ghost, and speaking in tongues, you ought to be able to speak praises in moments of problems. As one who knows that God can make a way out of no way, you ought to be the one person in the room that changes the atmosphere. People ought to stop cussing when you walk in the room. People ought to stop fussing when you open your mouth. People ought to just sit back and be quiet because you are a child of God. You see, when Jesus came into this room, y'all, the presence of Jesus made a difference that the fever had to... Okay, I'm getting ahead of myself. You see, I want you to see this 14th verse of the 8th chapter of Gospel of Matthew is a picture of the fact that the home that Peter resided in was a home of love, and a home of love was a home of hospitality. I already told you, he lived there, his brother lived there, his wife lived there, his mother, there had to be some love up in that whole house, y'all. And because there was love there, there was hospitality. And Minister Donna, I knew you were going to be in the service this morning, so I had to do an etymology study on the word hospitality. Hospitality, Brother L, is a Greek word from philoxeno. Philoxeno, y'all, means the fond of strangers. Okay, when you are hospitable, you are fond of strangers. That's why the book of Hebrew tells us, be careful how you entertain strangers. They may be angels unaware. Be careful how you entertain folk who don't look like you or talk like you or speak like you or dress like you. They may be angels unaware. You're looking at me on the screen right now, but some of you have turned your nose up and turned your face and rolled your eyes and sucked your teeth at some very angels that God was sending your way. You see, hospitality was practiced in the house of Peter's mother-in-law. Hospitality was practiced with these adults. And when you have hospitality, it's always undergirded by love. Let me see if I can give a funny story to you about what true hospitality is. Story is told, Dr. Monroe, of a lady who invited some friends over for dinner. And a little girl was with her, 6 years old. And so the mother said, well, why don't you, honey, since my friends are here, you've been studying the Bible, why don't you say the grace? And so the little girl says, mommy, I don't know what to say. She says, oh, I've got my friends here, just go ahead and pray. Pray the way you would think mommy would pray. And so she closed her eyes and folded her hands and she says, dear Lord, I don't know why I invited all these people to my house. In Jesus' name, amen. Oh, you got to be careful what you say around your children. They will repeat it. You see, hospitality, y'all, is more than just inviting folk to our house to have dinner. Hospitality is more than just rolling down your windows and giving out a bottle of water to a stranger. Hospitality is more than just giving somebody a courtesy call. Hospitality is involved and undergirded with love. You have to have a spirit of hospitality about yourself. Let me show the difference to you or what hospitality is. Karen Maines breaks it down this way. Karen says that there's a difference between hospitality and entertainment. Entertainment, she says, is saying, I want to impress you with my home. But hospitality says, home is a gift from Almighty God. Karen says, entertainment is for show. I want to show off my house. Hospitality is to serve, meaning I want whosoever will to come in. Karen says, entertainment puts things before people. As soon as I get my furniture, and as soon as I get my living room fixed up, and as soon as I get some curtains, y'all can come over. Hospitality says, people are first. Y'all better come on in. in this house, sit on a box, sit on a milk crate. You better pull up a cardboard somewhere and make yourself at home. Entertainment says, I can't feed you unless we eat off of some china and some silverware. Hospitality simply says, you better get some paper plates, some paper towels, and some paper forks from the Domino's and come on and help yourself. You see, you got to realize when God blesses you, not just with house or with car or with home or with clothes, you've got to have a hospitable spirit. The presence of God makes all the difference. I want you to understand. But secondly, look at the power of God through Jesus Christ, because verse 15 says, he touched her hand and the fever left her. He touched her hand, the Bible says, Brother Sean, and the fever left her. Now, what's significant about this, y'all, is the power of Jesus is immediately seen in the fact that the fever of Peter's mother-in-law left when he touched her. See, the word touched, according to the Greek, Pastor Lansden, speaks of handling something in such a way that the object touched is modified as a result of the influence exerted. Ooh, that was deep. Let me say it again. The word touch means is that the object touch is influenced, shall we say, by the one that was touching it, and the one that touched it has such a power to change the subject itself. You see, it's like old school. You remember back in the day when all you had was some water and all of a sudden you had that tang, that instant tang. Now, it wasn't sweet, but it was orange and it smelled a little bit. And because it got into the water that was clear, then the water became orange and you thought you had something good. It wasn't nothing but colored water. The power of the one touching had the way of changing the circumstance around it. And somebody looking at me right now, God wants to make a house call to you and not just come by, but God wants to touch you. God wants to make a house call to you and not just make a drive-by, but pull up into your living room, pull up into your kitchen, pull up into your bedroom and make a difference in your life. What does the book of Revelations tell us? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. And if anyone would answer the door, Jesus says, I will come in and sup with you, sit down with you, and listen to you, and I will be a difference in your life. Oh, hear what I'm saying this morning, because as we go into a new month, as we go into the last month of winter, getting ready to go into springtime, God is saying, I'm going to touch you in a special way. My friends, do you realize the first Sunday in March was the last time that I preached in this sanctuary in front of all of y'all? Pastor Lansden preached the second Sunday in March, and that's the last time y'all been in here, and I can't wait till you get back after your vaccine. But until you do, I want you to know that this is an anniversary moment for me. This is a time that I'm celebrating here. This is a moment that I don't want to forget, that the presence of God and also the touch of God that God is trying to make in our homes right now. No, you would not have thought about watching your preachers on a screen. You would not have thought about going to Facebook this time last year. You would not have thought we didn't even have a YouTube channel this time last year. But thanks be to God, we're touching not just the 500 folk we used to see on Sunday morning. We're touching hundreds of folk every day. We're touching thousands of folk every week. We're doing all God can give us to do because of the touch and the presence. Oh, the presence, because you see, I want you to recognize is that the Bible says is that when Jesus touched Sister Margaret Winch, Jesus touched the mother-in-law of Peter, the fever left. Now, don't get too deep on me, but I want you to see what happened. When Jesus touched, the fever left. The power of God was so strong, Dr. Monroe, is that when Jesus touched the sick woman, the fever got up and ran. Now, in the word of that great poet Martin, who says, you ain't got to go home. but you got to get up out of here. Brother George, understand that Jesus touched a woman and there was not enough space in the place for the fever to stay. Somebody hear what I'm saying this morning. When God touches your heart and touches your soul and touches your spirit, the devil's got to get up and go to stepping. The devil's got to get up and go to running. The devil's got to get up and get behind me, Satan, because the power of Almighty God is so strong that we ain't got enough space for the devil and God to be in the same space. Somebody need to tell the devil in your life, get to stepping. Somebody need to tell the devil in your spirit, get to stepping. Somebody need to tell the devil on your job, get to stepping. Matter of fact, type right there in the chat box, get to stepping. Get to stepping out of my, get the hell out of my life, because I'm a child of Almighty God. Get to stepping. The text tells us, my friends, is that the touch was so strong and such part of compassion. You see, God gives us a compassionate heart. So don't ever get it confused. Just because you touched by God, you can tell folk off. Don't think just because you've been touched by God, you always right and you always having the last word. No, being touched by God gives you compassion, gives you empathy, gives you sympathy, gives you kindness, gives you a caring heart. And never forget this. Brother Mike, I've said it before. Here it is. People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. This compassion of Jesus was so strong that the touch, it touched not just the mother-in-law, but it touched her spirit. That's the last point I want to make, because you see, y'all, it's not just the presence of God, but it's not just the touch of God, but it's the appreciation of God. That's what I want you to take home with you, because the Bible says that, and she got up and waited on him. She got up and waited. The mother-in-law got up and waited on Jesus. The Gospel of Mark says that she got up and waited on the disciples. The Gospel of Luke says that she got up and served. Matthew said, but then she got up and waited on Jesus. Now understand that when Jesus spoke to the leper and when Jesus spoke to the centurion, he spoke of their healing. But the Bible says when he touched the woman, she got up and served. And y'all don't miss that, because I think that there is some power in her testimony. You see, when Jesus touched her, she didn't stay in the condition that she was in. What did he say to the woman at the well? He simply says, I want to restore you. And she says, I'm going to go back and tell other folk all about you, everything you told me. He touched her and she made a difference. What did he say to the man who was born blind and he healed him and he began to go and testify of the goodness of the Lord? What did Jesus say to the man who wanted to be made well and jumped in the water and the waters weren't stirred, and Jesus simply healed him and said, go and sin no more? You see, my point is that when Jesus touched her, she could not have been a good witness if she would have stayed in the bed. And somebody hear what I'm saying this morning, because when God touches you, you can't be the witness God wants you to be if you stand in your sin and stand in your bed of affliction and stand in your can't do and can't get up, stand with a stinking thinking, stand in your addiction. When God touches you, it's time for you to get up and to serve. It's time for you to get up and to move. It's time for you to get up and to study. It's time for you to get up and to be. The woman, y'all, she got up. Her witness, y'all, was one that was an active witness. And you're looking at me now and you're saying, well, Reverend, that was a long time ago, and that was 2,000 years ago. How can this word apply to me? Well, when you read it, I want you to understand the verb that she waited on them. The tense in the Greek is a imperfect tense. And as Miss Rosebud would help me with my word study, she would say imperfect tense means, Reverend, that it's always going. It's ongoing, which means that this woman, y'all, she didn't serve Jesus just at that time. She just served Jesus continuously. She knew that son-in-law of hers, Peter, would be leaving them and being a fisher of men, would be leaving her daughter, leaving maybe his children. So she was going to have to keep on serving. She recognized that Peter's brother, Andrew, would be leaving the house. So all we got now are two women running a house. Thanks be to God, because women can run a house. But she served. She served with passion. She served continuously. And somebody looking at me right now, I want you to know, when God makes a house call to you, a home delivery, it's time for you to get up and to serve. It's time for you to get up and to
go. Thank you so much for being a part of this service today. It has been a plumb pleasing pleasure and a privilege to share the word. Thank you, Pastor Lansden, for your presence. Do know, my friends, if you are desirous of a place you can grow in the Lord right now, I want you to type your name, type your wishes, your desires, and we want to be a community of faith to help you grow. Don't forget, every morning at 7 o'clock, join us for our prayer and devotional time. There are small groups. There are activities how you can stay involved in the church. Matter of fact, following the benediction of this service, our youth, our children, all of those multiple generations can stay connected to the church. Go to the website, get all of that information. We love you. We want you to be a part of CN Jenkins. This is Pastor Kansas and Pastor Lansden. Y'all have a wonderful day. God bless you. Thank you.